wanted to begin by saying that what I'm going to do today is a continuation of what I did already when I came here in December. And it's too bad that I don't, with only a few faces, I don't see the same audience, which is too bad because the people who came last time, it would have been good to come now, you know, and the people who are now, it should have been good to be there. But that happened when you have the, because I'm going to presuppose today what I said already. I'm not going to repeat. And so I'm doing it on purpose because there was an audio that unfortunately haven't been uploaded yet, but I'm asking to please, please, please upload it.
Yes, everything will be online.
Don't wait more time, upload it. So because now I could have said to you, go to this link, it's there, check it out, because now you will see the sequence, you see? Last time I dedicated, I don't know, 1.5 hours to the conquest of Al-Andalus and the world historical significance of the conquest of Al-Andalus. And today I'm going to now continue with that lecture, okay, about the consequences of the conquest of Al-Andalus to the modern structures of knowledge, you see? And if you didn't hear the previous part, there's going to be gaps here. Okay, so unfortunately, but I'm doing it on purpose because now with this instrument called, you know, videos and stuff like that, if you do this, you know, then if you upload the material, then people can now, you know, have access to this without me being here. You see what I mean? And you can listen any, you know, several times if you want. You know, there's a lot of details in this war history, you know, and so I'm going to, basically I was, you know, at the end of the conquest of Al-Andalus, okay, and probably some of you don't know what I'm talking about now. What is Al-Andalus? Al-Andalus was that part of Islamic civilization in the south of Europe, and then by the end of the 15th century in the south of Spain, okay? That was the last remaining part, and in the reason I'm going through the conquest of Al-Andalus is because all the methods used for colonization, okay, were there already, okay, in the conquest of Al-Andalus in the late 15th century. You could see how everything they did there, then they, when they expanded to the Americas, especially the Iberian Peninsula, that was the first moment of the European colonial expansion, was to Al-Andalus, conquering Islamic civilization in the south of Spain. That was the first moment. Then, when they finished with that, they moved to the Americas. And then they moved to Asia and Africa, you see? And so they keep going, okay? And then the Iberian Peninsula got displaced later, in the 17th century, and then you have the Dutch coming in, later the British, later the Americans, etc. You know, but this began way back. And the reason I go way back is not for not some nostalgia about the past, how great Andalusian civilization was, you know, which is true, it was great, it was amazing, the kind of thing that happened in Islamic, in Andalusia, you know, in Al-Andalus. It was an amazing, amazing, you know, part of Islamic civilization, okay, and with a lot of interesting things happening there from all points of view, okay? But I'm not doing this because of that. I'm doing this because the methods they used to colonize Al-Andalus were later rehearsed elsewhere. And I mentioned two fundamental methods that I cannot go in detail now. One was the encomienda. The encomienda was used as a method of colonization for everywhere they went. They brought Christian families from the north. They took the land of the Muslim and Jews in Al-Andalus, and they occupied the land and killed everybody who did not convert. Anybody who resists conversion to Christendom, they would be killed. And those who survived were people that were forced to conversion. Okay, and so this moment is a very important moment because of the world historical significance of this. Because then the encomienda was a system they used to then it's a system of forced labor. Those who survived, because they were forced to conversion, and they decided not to to put the people who they conquered to work by force in something called the encomienda, okay? And then today we have a vocabulary to name this, okay? Because that's the first moment of what is known in the literature today as settler colonialism. They brought families from the north, they took over the land of the natives, you know, native people in the land, and then they took over. And those who survived, you know, the ethnic cleansing, were then put to work by force, certain number of hours a day for the encomendero, the guy who, the father figure of the family who comes from the north and occupied the land. That's settler colonialism that has been going on from the conquest of Al-Andalus all the way till, you know, passing through South Africa, Australia, New Zealand. You know, you go over the world and you see all these settler colonial projects going on in many parts of the world, Argentina, Chile, Canada, USA. All of these are settler colonial societies, all the way to Palestine today, that is being occupied under settler colonial system, you see? So that began over there, okay? And then, of course, there's a high correlation between settler colonialism and genocide, because the interest of the colonizer is more to take over the land and resources and occupy the territory rather than exploiting labor, okay? So there's a high correlation. So the labor is disposable. The people that have been conquered, it's disposable, they can throw them out, you know? So they are there for a different project. They're not there to use the labor, but to take over the land, properties, everything, okay? And that's when they just can dispense of the human beings there, you see? And that's where you get the correlation between settler colonialism and genocide, okay? So that moment was a form of genocide, okay? That moment, what happened in Al-Andalus, it was ethnic cleansing, it was settler colonialism, it was all of this, but also there was another aspect of it, which I also discussed last time, which was the problem of wherever they conquer, they will burn the libraries. Okay, so they burn the libraries. So I call this epistemicide, destruction of the knowledge structures. Okay, to erase the memory of the people colonized from the narratives, okay, from the narratives that were put forward, you know, by Muslims, Jews, etc., who were there, living there, and also Christians who were living there together with the Muslim and Jews with no problem, okay? Because under Islamic rule, I explained that last time, there was the recognition of the rights of everybody. There was no situation where one group will be, you know, wipe out, you know, exterminate, or things like this. This was a Christendom problem. I said Christendom, I didn't say Christianity. I say Christian, I explained that last time. So now the question I would like to raise today is, why is it that you have structures of knowledge that are so racist and sexist in the modern world? Why? What do I mean by that? I mean that in what we call the university, which I prefer to call the westernized university, the canon of thought is fundamentally Western males of 5 countries. So any discipline you go, you will find Western males of 5 countries. Okay? And what you're going to find is basically you're going to be reading. The names change across discipline, but the nationalities are the same. Okay, so you will get a French, a German, a British, a North American, especially USA, and secondarily an Italian. That's what you will get more or less in most of the discipline. Maybe you will get a Swedish here, or maybe a Dutch there, or maybe a Canadian over there, but very secondarily. The great majority of the authors you're going to read in a university like this one, and I call it Westernized University, it's a global structure of power. I didn't say Western University, I said Westernized. This is important because today it's a global structure of power. You could be in Dakar, in Senegal. You could be in Johannesburg, in South Africa. You could be in New Delhi, in India. You could be wherever you go, and you are. You will see the Westernized University. You come to a classroom anywhere in the world where you have Westernized University, and you're going to read a white male of one of these five countries. That's what you're going to be reading. And the more to the south you go, the more ridiculous it becomes. Right? Because if you go to a place like South Africa, okay, and you are in South Africa or in Dakar, and you're reading white man of five countries talking about Italy, Germany, UK, and the pretension of this university is that you're supposed to master these authors to apply them elsewhere. So this is the assumption, that these authors are superior beings that have universal knowledge that you're supposed to apply elsewhere. What about the authors that have thought the realities of other places in the world? Okay? So these people have thought the realities of Italy, France, UK, etc. And so they are thinking from the social historical experience of these countries, okay? And with the problems that they were facing, 19th century, 20th century. But then the question is why these authors and the theories they produce based on the problems of Germany, France, UK, etc. are relevant for Senegal, South Africa, Brazil, India, Pakistan, etc. And the assumption is that they produce the theories that are going to be universal, that are going to be superior for the rest of the world to understand the realities. If you think carefully, we're talking about 12% of humanity. In this case, these five countries form 12% of humanity. Okay. The social historical experience of 12% of humanity is giving the theoretical tools to understand the social historical experience of 88% of humanity. You get the point? It becomes very ridiculous when you start thinking carefully about it. And the other thing is that it's worse than 12%, because it's the males of the five countries and women are not there. It's only 6% of humanity, of the social historical experience. The theories coming out of the social historical experience of 6% of humanity are giving you the theoretical tools to understand the social historical experience of the rest of humanity. The assumption is that it's as if the theories were beyond time and space. That's one of the assumptions. It's a God-eye view, right? That it doesn't matter time or space, these theories are valid everywhere in the world. But the social historical experience of China, India, Africa, or you go around the world, are completely different from what these people theorize. And therefore requires of different concepts to understand the other realities. You see? Because there are social historical experiences that are completely different. And it's not as if they're not. There haven't been authors in those parts of the world that have thought about the realities. They are there. There are plenty of them. But why they're not part of the canon of thought of the Westernized University? They're out. I call this epistemology epistemic racism sexism. Because you are inferiorizing the thought of the rest of humanity. And you're putting as the superior knowledge 6% of human beings in the world. Follow me? The white man. But not every white man of five countries. It's very interesting. Okay? Not every white man of five countries. So when people talk that we need to decolonize the curriculum, and we need to decolonize the university, and we need to decolonize knowledge production, we need to know where are we decolonizing from. You follow me? So, so one of the things we're decolonizing from is this. This problem, okay? So the problem that we have now is that in order to talk about decolonization, you need to know what is being colonized, you see? You know, what is the colonial structure you're fighting? You don't know that, you're lost, okay? You're lost because you don't know what you're doing, you know, basically. So the thing I'm going to now discuss is why we have such racist, sexist structural knowledge. You know, why is it that we are still there, okay, in the 21st century? And I'm going to argue that there are four genocide epistemicides, you know, in the long 16th century, okay? Four genocide epistemicides, okay?